Yeah. Yeah. Draft day, Johnny Manziel. 5 years later, how am I the man still? Draft day, A. Wiggins. That other side, we stay winning. Oh man, you know I had to do it for you. You know I had to do it for you. Yeah. Suits and ties yelling out, pay the guys, man, I had to do it for you. You know I had to do it for you. You know I had to do it for you. Oh man, oh man, oh man, man, you know I had.
Welcome back to the Racial Draft Podcast. I'm Michael Ford. No guest this week, just me rolling solo. We'll see if anyone hops on to the little solo cast, but you know, it's gonna be a little low key. We're just gonna recap week 8 or round 8, as it were, of the season 6 racial draft. If this is your first episode, I apologize, but again, we are going to do what we do every week. I messed up the catchphrase. Change the complexion of the comic book universe one draft pick at a time via the racial draft. And yeah, let's just get right into it. It was a pretty low-key week in terms of the caliber of picks. Nothing too high, nothing too low, I suppose, is the best way of characterizing it. And, you know, starting us out is a pick that's fairly straightforward, I would say. And that would be Natasha Romanoff, the Black Widow for the Jewish delegation. You know, there's really not a lot to say about this pick. We've seen it in other seasons. Obviously, there is a Jewish community in Russia. There has been traditionally a Jewish community in Russia who's been a little bit, kind of in the lower echelons of Russian society, and you know, many of whom actually left Russia to come to the States. So I would say, in the context of that story, you know, having a Jewish Russian girl get pulled into the Black Widow program, recruited and trained and going through that, especially during the Cold War years, that to me seems pretty apropos. It doesn't seem like that big of a stretch. Also, in terms of the fan cast, Scarlett Johansson, who is also Jewish, kind of made the role famous. So, you know, I would say on both those fronts, you know, it's a very solid pick for the Jewish delegation. And yeah, the audience approval scores bear that out, in that currently the pick is sitting at 91.6% approval, and the fan cast, sticking with Scarlett Johansson, that's at 100%. So, I mean, you really can't argue with those numbers. Very strong pick, and very strong approval of said pick. So let's move on to the second pick of round 8. This one's a little bit more controversial, I would say. I would say it's more controversial given just the way that the draft has shaken out so far. Decontextualized. I wouldn't say it's too tough of a pick, but you know, this is the Latinx delegation choosing to make Latino Danny Ketch, aka Ghost Rider, the second Ghost Rider in the kind of modern conception of the character. Obviously, Johnny Blaze, the original, is the one that is the most famous. And then, of course, you've got Robbie Reyes, who is still on the board, the kind of modern, younger version of Ghost Rider, who's, you know, generally traditionally associated with, you know, with Latinx culture, specifically Mexican-American culture. So again, this character's still on the board, but, you know, in keeping with Latino delegate Carlos's strategy of focusing primarily on the comics and how often these characters appear in the comics, I know that there is a Danny Ketch solo book that is has kicked off. But you know, I would say that Robbie Reyes is probably more popular. I would also say that you know, he's had his moment to kind of carve out his niche in the zeitgeist. So I can, while I can understand strategically some of the advantages of acquiring Danny Ketch, you know, it's going to be very curious if they end up not getting the next delegations of not getting Robbie Reyes because they chose to prioritize Danny Ketch. But what I was, you know, beyond that, I would also say that he's also the long lost brother of Johnny Blaze, who was drafted by the Native American delegation. Now, obviously, I'm sure there are ways in, especially in terms of the fact that they were long lost, the fact that Danny was raised by an adoptive, actually, they may have both been raised by adoptive families. So the adoption aspect might be a way of explaining the, the different cultural aspects, particularly, you know, if their backstories are kind of geared towards the Southeast, the Southwest United States, where there are Latin communities, as well as Native American communities that are in very close proximity. So, I mean, it's not a leap that's impossible to make, but it is one that does kind of create a little bit of discordance, so to speak. You know, add in the fact that this is a character that is traditionally depicted as white, but that's not an issue here where we exist in the racial draft. There's no reason that Danny Ketch, I mean, beyond his name, really, there's no reason that Danny Ketch couldn't be Latino, particularly white passing Latino from the perspective of the visuals. So on that note, you know, I'm kind of wavery on as far as my own approval of the pick. The people are currently a little bit mixed as well. Right now, 71.5% of the people approve of this pick, and that would include, that would include 28.6 strongly approve, 42.9 somewhat approve, 14.3 somewhat disapprove, and 14.3% racist. From the fan cast perspective, I'm not as impressed. I gotta be honest. This actor Rick Gonzalez, I've seen him in some things. I do know he was in a movie a few years back called Biker Boys, so perhaps that was the impetus for the casting. But I want to say, let me make sure about this, because I mean, I want to say Rick Gonzalez is Puerto Rican, and kind of from the East Coast, from New York. Let me make sure that I'm not stereotyping my New Yorkers, but I want to say Dominican and Puerto Rican. Yeah, so from New York, Dominican, Puerto Rican. I definitely associate him more with East Coast style characters than West Coast style characters. Obviously, we've been known to see actors kind of cross-pollinate when they're Latino. But this is, you know, this one's tough for me because I've seen Rick Gonzalez in some things, and he just doesn't strike me as kind of like the Western USA type of kind of guy. So maybe that's, let me check something. I want to say, let me make sure that Danny Ketch didn't spend some time in New York. Maybe Carlos knows something that I don't. I'm not seeing it. I'm going to keep going. Sorry, listeners. Normally, there would be someone here to talk us through. There'd be someone here to talk us through while I do my Google's live on the podcast. But Yeah, just keep bearing with me, because I do know he has. Once he became Ghost Rider, he spent a fair amount of time in New York, but I don't. Be that as it may, I mean, I think that for me personally, I think that it's a little bit easier for, if you're going to sort of keep the link between Johnny Blaze and Danny Ketch, I think it would make more sense for Danny Ketch to be Mexican rather than Puerto Rican. That's just kind of my own take on it, you know. And so for that, I mean, I'm not really. Not really feeling the fan cast here. And that does kind of put me in line with the people who are at this point split 50-50. 50-50 approving, 50-50 disapproving, 41.7 strongly approve, 8.3 somewhat approve, 41.7 somewhat disapprove, and 8.3 strongly disapprove. So, yeah, it's going to be tough. It's an uphill climb with just a little under a day left. In terms of casting your vote. But if you feel otherwise, go ahead, racialdraft.com. You can find those polls there. You can also find them on Twitter at the Racial Draft Pod Twitter account. So we shall see how that plays out. Let's move on to the third pick of the round, the Black delegation with their pick, third pick in the round, Kendra Saunders. Who is often depicted as Black. She's also typically depicted as Afro-Latina, but not always. But I do think that after my conversation with Delegate Randy from the Black delegation, his intention was for her to be Afro-Latina. You know, there's not a lot to say about this. Like I said, it's a character that my understanding has never been depicted as anything other than either just regular Black woman or Afro-Latina. You know, I she's meant to be another of the Thanagarian, reincarnated humans whose souls kind of date back all the way to ancient Egypt. You know, so for that reason, you know, there's already a rationale for the character to be, have ties to Africa for lack of a better term. Additionally, there's this fact that the Black delegation already drafted Black Hawkman, Carter Hall. So he's, you know, there's two black Hawks. I think that whatever we hear, whatever direction that we sort of see in the future, from the DC films, I do think that Carter Hall, as played by why is his name I'm really apologizing. Let's see if I can remember the actor who played Hawkman. That would be Aldous Hodge. Sorry. Oh man, what a brain fart. So yes, Aldous Hodge, he actually did, in my opinion, a really good job as Hawkman. So to that end, you know, I think that if to the extent that they'd like to kind of keep Hawkman Black, keeping Hawk Girl Black, it's perfectly a-okay with me. The people agree with that for the most part. 80% approval rating for this pick, with 70% strongly approve, 10% somewhat approve, 10% somewhat disapprove, 10% racist. Gotta say, you gotta be racist to be against the Black character being drafted to stay Black. So I was just kind of keep that in my back pocket, so to speak. We will move on to the fourth pick of the round. This one is a little tough, I admit, a little tough to wrap your mind around. I did expect by now for the Native American delegation to put out a few words in support of the pick. And my guess is that they're going to suffer. I know he and I talked, Toriano from the Native American delegation did talk through the pick. So I know what his intentions are. but he hasn't, you know, put out any statements in support of the pick. And like I said, that's probably going to make it harder for people to see the vision here. And the vision here is Groot, Native American Groot. Now, obviously, those of you who've seen the Guardians movies know that Groot is meant to be an alien from a planet of humanoid trees. So already from a storyline perspective, you've got to figure out how to tie this race of humanoid trees to Native American culture. I mean, I think it's doable. I think you can talk about this race as kind of spacefaring. One thing that we do know about Groot is that the seedlings can grow in a multitude of places, and there's some sense that a piece of Groot can grow into a full-grown Groot. So maybe there's a logic behind a version of Groot who spent some time with the Native Americans at one point in time, and you know, kind of broke off a piece of that Groot. Apologize. And then from there, you know, went ahead. These people kind of traveled to their place, set up shop, did whatever they do, and maybe came back and retrieved a young Groot after he had been, you know, kind of raised amongst the Native American people. Or maybe there was an ancestor Groot that was, you know, kind of spent an even longer time among a particular tribe of Native Americans and was kind of brought into the fray, brought in and accepted. And then, you know, then he went back out to space. I think that there's room to make the story work. But again, you know, just kind of on its own, I can totally understand why people might not approve. And yeah, that's what seems to be getting borne out right now. As of now, the approval rating for the pick is 62.5%. Fairly low for one of Toriano's picks. 37.5 strongly approve, 25% somewhat approve, 25% somewhat disapprove, and 12.5%. Is that racist or is that like tree-ist? Not sure. I mean, I'll ask Scarlett Johansson about that. She's the expert on people playing trees. We will move on from one kind of shapeshifter to another, to the multiracial delegation. As I've often mentioned on this podcast, I do feel like the multiracial delegation is the skeleton key delegation in that, you know, there are so many characters who can easily be reimagined as multiracial, given how you would like to define those multi-races. Particularly, I would say, in the case of Mystique, we don't really know a lot about her origins. So the fact that we don't know a lot about her origins means that she could have relationships and cultural identities that vary across different cultures at different time frames, different parts of the world. You know, there's just any number of cultures that Mystique could fit in if she was particularly born that way and born of people of two different ethnicities in the first place, let alone the fact that over the hundreds of years that she's been alive, she could have been accepted into a multitude of cultures based on her ability to shapeshift. So for me, it just seems perfect. Seems like a no-brainer. The people are a little bit more skeptical than I expected. As of now, the approval rating for the pick is 76.9%. 69.2 strongly approve, 7.7 somewhat approve, 15.4% somewhat disapprove of multiracial Mystique, and then 7.7% racist. But, you know, like I said, I don't see the issue. I don't see the problem. I think it could totally work. Raven Darkholm. There are a lot of, you know, a lot of different way, the different directions you can go in terms of telling her backstory and making her fit firmly within, you know, any kind of mixture of multiple races. You know, why should white women have all the fun playing Mystique, as far as I'm concerned? This next pick is a little bit more controversial, I would say. Particularly, we just came off of the multiracial aspect of it, and that would be Elektra Nachios, aka Elektra, aka Daredevil. You know, you would have known her from the old school Daredevil movie, played by Jennifer Garner. You may also know her from the Netflix series played by Elodie Young. Who is, I believe, I want to say French and Cambodian. But, you know, her origin generally is that she's Greek. Obviously, she could be adopted. She could be or she could be raised by a Greek family of East Asian descent. Sorry, this was the East Southeast Asian delegation that drafted Elektra. You know, ethnically, there's that issue, but, you know, there can be East Asians in Greece. There can be East Asian man who adopts, you know, cross racially, adopts a daughter, names her Elektra, gives her his last name, and that would explain, similarly to how we saw it in the Daredevil show, that would explain why she was Greek, but she was not ethnically Greek. So for that reason, you know, I don't really have a reason to disapprove of this. And it's, you know, it's cool that the voters, the audience at large, kind of feel similar to me. Right now, the approval rating for the pick is sitting at 95.8%. Another thing that I should mention is that another reason that Elektra seems to fit so well within sort of East Asian culture is all of the East Asian tropes that are applied to Elektra. One of the reasons that Elodie Young was praised in the casting was that instead of it being a white woman who embraces all of these sort of ninja East Asian cultural reference and tropes, which could be viewed as problematic by it being an Asian woman, an East Asian woman, considerably less so. Less orientalist tropes, and that may be another reason that the people are sort of predisposed to the approval here, and you know, again, I'm among them, so. But yes, I should have mentioned before, 79.2 strongly approve, 16.7 somewhat approve, 0 somewhat disapprove, and 4.2% racist. For the fan cast, Rina Sawayama, who you might have seen in the most recent John Wick movie. I forgot her character's name. She worked in the Japanese, in the Tokyo Continental. Spoiler alert for the movie, she's a badass. So big fan of her performance as a badass in John Wick. Totally think that she could play, excuse me, a badass as Elektra. Only thing is that she doesn't quite have the full hair that is often associated with Elektra. But other than that, big approve. The people are a little bit more mixed on Rina Sawayama than they are the casting overall. I'm sorry, than the draft pick overall. But 75% of the people do approve of Rina Sawayama rather, as Elektra. 50% strongly approve, 25% somewhat approve, 15% somewhat disapprove, 10% racist. But that brings us to the next pick. Seventh pick of the round. This is another repeater pick from last season. That would be Kraven the Hunter. Earlier this week, we got a trailer for the new Kraven movie. Spoiler alert for that movie, he was just a regular white guy. In fact, not even a Russian white guy. He kind of had a British accent, either a British accent or an American accent, but definitely not a Russian accent. His father, played by Russell Crowe, did have a Russian accent. So they definitely want him, Sergei Kravinoff, to still be Russian. But, they went extra Caucasian there. But here we have with the Swana Mena delegation, Turkish Kraven. I would say that the way that he's typically depicted, even though his backstory is one that is supposed to be of Russian aristocracy, his look is often very kind of, for her lack of a better term, swarthy and brownish and bearded, and the kinds of things that you might associate with the groups of Russians that are more ethnically distinct from pure Aryanism. And for that reason, there is a fair amount of Turkish communities in Russia. So this would be a Turkish-Russian version of Kraven. There are some actors that kind of look the part of what you might associate with Kraven. One of them is Numan Akar. He appeared in not the most recent Spider-Man movie, in Spider-Man Far From Home. At the time that he was cast, I do remember people thinking, oh, could he be playing Kraven? He really does look like comic book Kraven. Alas, he was not. He was just playing kind of a European, generic European spy badass. So both the casting as of now and the draft pick are at 72.7% approval, with 72.7 all strongly approve, 18.2 somewhat disapprove, and 9.1 racist. But let's keep it moving. The eighth pick of the round. This one's a little bit of a tough one, got to admit. This is the South Asian delegation, and Rogue, aka Anna Marie, aka Suga. Very, very. I mean, I don't know. I mean, this is a character that is very kind of closely associated with being Southern and Southern culture. Obviously there are South Asians who live in the South, and I'm sure that there are South Asians who speak enough with an accent that you would think of, you would hear their voice and think, oh yeah, she's definitely from the South. But her story is so tied to, how do I explain this? The downtrodden, poor, almost rural, trailer-ish communities in the South. I want to say she's from Mississippi. Don't quote me. Let me look that up. But I want to say she's from Mississippi, even though, it wouldn't be wrong for people to assume that she was from Georgia. But like I said, I think she's from Mississippi. Let me check. Wait for it. She was, Caldecott County, Mississippi. So, it's obvious that she could still be South Asian, like I said. But that's a tough one for me, because even though it's more her culture than her race, you do somewhat brush up against the character as South Asian being kind of like her primary identifier. It would be I don't know enough about the fan cast. Let me look up the fan cast. Risha Morjani. Maybe she's from the American South. That would be kind of cool. Maybe that would help help bridge the gap. Nope, she is from California. Sorry. You know, not to say that she couldn't pull off a Southern accent, but you know, it's pushing up against what I feel like is a perfect fan cast. I mean, I do like the character of Rogue. I think the character of Rogue is fairly popular. You know, there was a thing last year where a lot of people wanted. Oh man, what is happening with my brain this weekend, guys? I apologize. Kiki Palmer, thank you. There were a lot of people who were fan casting Kiki Palmer, and they sort of decided that the main focus, you know, is she thick enough? Check. And can she do the sugar? Can she do the Southern accent? And once people saw that she could, they were like all over the internets, photoshopping and fan cast, you know, photoshopping and fan art of Kiki Palmer. You know, she did, I believe, for, I want to say it was either Halloween or some other excuse to do cosplay of Rogue. So if there's some cosplay or fan art of South Asian Rogue, I mean, again, Rogue is a fairly popular character, so I wouldn't be surprised if there are South Asian cosplayers who do Rogue. But again, from a canon perspective, let's go back and rewrite the story of the character and make Anna Marie South Asian. It's a tough one for me. The people, yeah, they're sort of torn as well. 61.1% approval, 50% strongly approve, 11.1 somewhat approve, 33.3 somewhat disapprove, 5.6% racist. For the fan cast, looks like the fan cast is going over a little bit better. 73.7% approval rating there. So I guess people know Risha Morjani's work, and they're just kind of like, well, if we're gonna get a, if we're gonna get a South Asian Rogue, I suppose they could accept Risha Morjani. But again, 15.8. somewhat disapprove and 10.5% racist. So maybe the people down at the bottom do not approve of her acting. I haven't seen her work really except in a few clips, so I don't have a strong opinion one way or the other. You know, going from one traditionally Southern character to another traditionally Southern character, and even more traditional, well, I wouldn't say Southern per se, but more tied with farm rural life, and definitely with a countrified accent, and that would be Sam Guthrie. He of the Guthrie clan. He of I want to say Kentucky, so maybe that is Southern, isn't it? So yeah, from Mississippi to Kentucky, two really very, very, very associated with the South and associated with rural life, back to back. And that is the Polynesian delegation getting a piece of Sam Guthrie this time out. I got to be honest, I don't see it. I'd love to find out what the vision is for the fan cast for the actor with Samoan. So, you know, maybe there's something that I'm missing about Samoan communities in Kentucky. Obviously, there's probably Samoans out in Kentucky, but there's so much about this character, about Sam Guthrie, about his time as a coal miner's son. To the point that even some of the sort of white actors that we've seen play most notably in the New Mutants movie. Like, if you can't pull it off, and I didn't think that that actor could, you know, pull it off. It's hard. It's hard to really get that, to really get that vision, in place, for Sam Guthrie, for Cannonball. So yeah, it's tough sell. The people are a little bit mixed, I suppose. 60% approval. So greater than 50%, not completely split. 50% strongly approve, by far the highest outcome. 10% somewhat approve, 10% somewhat disapprove, but 30% strongly disapprove. You know, and this is a tough one. You know, for me, generally, like, I can understand that there are a lot of characters that can be race bent without issue, but this one's tough because he's, like I said, his character is so associated with a particular kind of whiteness, particular kind of countryness, that it's hard for me even to imagine him of a different background, let alone Polynesian background. The fan cast, this is an actor that I'm in no way familiar with. Beulah Koale, I apologize. Like I said, who's Samoan. Let me look him up and find out whether maybe he's from Kentucky. He is not. He is from New Zealand. So, yeah, I mean, it's, I'm not really seeing it. But you know, he seems to have been put in a fair amount of work. He's a little on the old side for Sam Guthrie. He's 30. But you know, it is what it is. But he too is getting a 60% approval rating. But in his case, it's all 60% strongly approve. And then there's 40% somewhat disapprove. So, you know, not my cup of tea this time around for Cannonball, but you know, I think we're finishing up fairly strong with the 10th pick of the round from the white delegation, and that's Donna Troy. Now, granted, you know, Donna Troy is a character that, given a very complicated backstory. With that backstory, there's a little bit of room in the shenanigans from the magic that created her, for her to have been a woman of color, even though technically she's supposed to be kind of a clone, if you will, a magical clone of Diana, of Wonder Woman. But from what I remember, the Wonder Woman fan cast to be, you know, she's a Wonder Woman, could be kind of closer to white ethnically. And of course, Donna could have been raised by white people and just, you know, what's the word I'm looking for? Embrace her white passingness, embrace her white culture. And since she grew up in America, I believe, could basically identify as white. And, you know, she visually, because of the fact that she's traditionally white, you know, I don't think there'd be much of an issue with that. So, you know, for me personally, I don't have a lot of objections with white Donna Troy, even though I do believe that, you know, there are some other delegations that could have put in a claim for Donna Troy, and they also would have had an opportunity to make it work. But que sera, sera on that point. Other delegations' losses is the white delegation's gain. So as of now, the approval on that pick is 78.5%. Wait, 78.5 approval rating for white Donna Troy. 57.1 strongly approve, 21.4 somewhat approve, 14.3 somewhat disapprove, and 7.1% woke. I mean, Those of you who are longtime listeners know that I don't use that word unironically, so that was just a joke. That was just a joke. Woke as a joke. But that was it. That's it. Those were the 10 picks. That was the round. I may as well give, for the benefit of the listeners, a rundown as of now. The top three delegations in third place, the Black delegation, the in second place, the Native American delegation, and currently in the lead in our competition is the Jewish delegation, which jumped out to a pretty strong lead over the weekend. So we shall see whether these rankings hold. We shall see what the ninth round brings. There's a lot. There's a lot of characters. This is where the rubber meets the road, so to speak. You could start quitting on your picks. There's potential trades that can be made. I'm always a big proponent of a win-win trade, trade makes everyone happy, including the listeners. But again, if you're a listener, go ahead, find us, find racialdraft.com. Comment there, vote in the polls, share with your friends, go to Twitter, go to Instagram, racial.draft on Instagram, go to Facebook, racial draft on Facebook. We don't have a TikTok yet, maybe next season, but YouTube, follow us on YouTube, get the weekly recaps, as they come out. Occasionally I'll put clips from the podcast, video clips. You can see my face, every now and then on the YouTube. But yeah, we enjoy the fan participation. We love that aspect. We're always trying to grow our community of commenters, of people with voices. If you're from a different delegation, go ahead and comment under the picks for your delegation. Propose some picks. We'll at least give it a listen. Go back to some of the old picks, and let the people, let your delegates know whether you approve or don't approve, even if the polls have been closed. Just kind of get it out there so that everyone can know, future seasons which direction to go. We still have for this season a second round, not second round, but a second go round of the Dynasty Draft, which means, that's where we play for keeps. So if there are some characters that you feel like must be drafted in this season's Dynasty Draft, go ahead and hit us up so that everyone knows that these are the characters that should be targeted. I'm a big fan of, like I said, this show wouldn't be this show without the listeners, without the audience, without the fan participation. So one more place that you can reach us, you can email us at racialdraftpodcast@gmail. And we'll give you, we'll read your feedback on the podcast. If you're on iTunes, go ahead and rate us 5 stars. As they say, if you rate us 4 stars, I'm inclined to think you're a hater, but rate us anyway. 5 stars, 5 stars, 5 stars. Rate us on Spotify if you have Spotify. We have ratings there. And of course you can, answer our Spotify poll where we always ask what your favorite pick of the round is. So, we've got myriad ways for you to reach out, for you to be part of the show in the smallest of smidgens. But that concludes this week's show. So, till next time. All things are possible.